for those who don't know me, my name is Ted Coons. I'm a retired fire chief and currently a volunteer division chief at Mulalla Fire. I'm also one of the ICs. Been in the program, I think, well, if you count my year off, this will be my 14th season. I've been around since it started, both Scott Majors and I, so we're the older statesmen, I guess, in the room of this program. Make a long story short there, it's my pleasure today to introduce our next topic. On your thing, it talks about tips of the trade, and probably the biggest tip we can give you is how to work within the structural triage and protection standards that we're going to be introducing over this next summer, and we need you to be familiar with those. So I'll let my friends up here introduce themselves, and we'll start with, you guys met Andy, but I'm going to make him introduce himself anyway.
Andy Loudon, Ops Chief on the Blue Team.
Alex Haven, Div Soup on the Blue Team.
Chris Barney, I'm a Div Soup with the Green Team.
And Chris is going to start us off this afternoon.
So thanks for everybody for being here. I was really excited when we found out that we were doing this event. I think it's really important to get out and meet you guys. I recognize a lot of people in the room from past seasons, and it's nice to see new faces too. So one thing I learned, tips of the trade, if we want to go out this season on a fire, we need to get Chief Coons to schedule a trip to the coast, right?
In your motorhome.
I think he had two trips last season, and both times got called back to fires. So that's the way for us to get out. And Mariana, I added this since I guess we're now, it's now an annual. So we'll see you guys next year. So really we're going to focus here on structural triage and structural protection standards. And I think this is going to be a little more along the lines of what we want to, all of us want to do out there, boots on the ground, getting our hands dirty, getting into things. So it should be a good hour or whatever time we have. And it's really, we want your input. So we're going to be asking some questions and stuff like that. One of the things, the reason why this idea for this little presentation came up, because last season there were, we all know, lots of different deployments, lots of different task forces out there. And from the INT side of things, we got into a position where we realized, hey, if I'm asking this task force to do something, their idea of what I'm asking may be very different from this task force over here. So we realized from our side, hey, maybe we just need to talk about some common language, common expectations of some of the common tasks and that we're asking you all to go out and do. So that's where we got to here, this point. So we're gonna start off just a little review of how the Div Soups and the task forces work together. I see it very much a partnership, more a partnership than a, hey, you work for me type of relationship. We're gonna go into triage, we're gonna go into structure protection, and then finish off with some defensible tactical actions, or just tactics of what we might be doing. So quickly, just a little bit about the Div Soup Task Force Leader Partnership. I think we're all very familiar with this diagram right here. I apologize if it's a little hard to see. But I wanted to really highlight is and we've talked about it several times throughout the day, is while we often refer to me as a Div Soup, more often than not, I'm out there working as a group soup, a structural group soup. And then one of the reasons why is, like we talked about, like Scott mentioned, we're out there a lot with ODF or another federal land agency, and we're working in partnership. One of the things that I've heard from the State Fire Marshal Office and from Mariana is that we really want to foster that partnership with ODF or with what other agency we're working for. And you know what? I'll say that over the last couple of years, I really think we've put in a lot of effort to that, and we are, every year, we make strides forward in that, and it's a very strong working partnership. And one of the things is we recognize how we can work together. And I feel like when I come to them and say, hey, look, to my ODF partner who's a Div Soup, I walk up and say, hey, I'm your group soup. He's expecting me to say Div Soup, and I say, no, I'm group soup. I'm here to work with you to accomplish the same things that you all hear. They're very much more open to that. And so I just wanted to touch on that relationship between me and the other Div Soups out there and how you and I are gonna operate and how you might be working if you hear me say group soup or something like that. The other thing is, if you look at the Div Soup responsibilities and the task force leader responsibilities, they are so similar. they're almost identical, but the real difference is scope. My scope may just be a little bit bigger than yours because you've got your task force to deal with, and I may have two or three. But I think when I looked at this, I really saw the similarities show the partnership that needs to happen between these two positions. Task force leaders are my eyes out there in your area of the division or where we're working. So I may come to you and say, hey, this is what we're expected, but I want you to go out there, tell me what you see, make good decisions, go forth, do good work, let me know what's going on, and if you needed to alter that plan. I'm putting a lot of faith in you guys because it's a partnership with you. This is what I want to have done, but I trust you to go forth and do it. Now, that doesn't mean to say that go forth and do whatever you want. Because we've talked a lot about responsibility and liability and stuff, I need to have some sort of final say on certain things. So obviously, keep those lines of communication open. But it's really a partnership between our two positions. So let's get into what we're here, structure triage. And what we're going to be eventually getting out to everybody is a common set of standards for structure triage and structure protection. And we're just working on this document right now. And we realize we don't have something standard that everybody's the same playbook we're all working off of. So we've just embarked on this process, and what we're going to provide to you is the beginnings of this. And we think it's a good step forward, and it's going to go forth to the ICs and hopefully then get pushed out to you at some point, either later this summer. We want to have it all ready for next season, 2017. But I want to introduce some of the ideas to you right now. So the big thing we're all looking at when we talk about structure triage is we've got a condition of what the house is like. The house, the vegetation around it, and the variables of time, fire condition, and resources. That's what gets us our triage category. And I know we've all been out there, we've had a busy season, we all know this, but I think what we're doing right here now is trying to get on the same page. We're gonna start talking about maybe some common vocabulary that we can all use so we're all understanding each other when we're out there working together. Anybody heard of the Oregon State Fire Marshal Structural Protection Checklist? We see one hand. Anybody know where it is? A few hands. Anybody know where you can find it? And I will preface that question by saying, not many of us up here did. Anybody know where you can find it? I know this table does. It's on the Oregon State Fire Marshal website under forms, right? IMT forms. Yeah, we had to find it. And so, hey, it may not be something that we're all that familiar with and where to go with it, but let's talk about it because I think we really know inherently what some of this means. So when we're talking about defensible, standalone, low-risk situations, a house that we're going to triage as standalone, what does that mean to you guys? I hear about it. Yes, lots of green space, some sort of safety zone that's right there, non-combustible roof. Yep. Maybe it might require some little bit of patrol, but nothing in it. It's pretty good. It might need a little prep work, but it's pretty much minimal work. The topography around it might not be too steep. How about a defensible prep and hold structure? Yeah, something that needs some work, but we need to, the probability of ignition is higher that we need to be there and protect it. It might have a safety zone, maybe. Prep and go. No escape route. That's no safety zone. That's probably the key one for that one. And a check and go or some sort of extreme risk structure. I think we've all seen those. We saw plenty of those last summer where it's that red rock, no go. So these are the terms that OSFM has in their checklist. And while we haven't seen it, I hadn't looked at it in a long time, I think we all inherently know it. But what we want to do is we want to get to an understanding across as many task forces as we can is what's the language behind each one of those. So when I'm talking to this table, who's Ashland, right? He goes, when I'm talking to an Ashland task force, you know, I can say, they can tell me, hey, we've got four homes that we've triaged, they're prep and go. Okay, so we are under a common language, and that makes sense to me. And again, we talked about what are the variables. All these are going to differ based upon what the fire conditions are. If we've got a huge wall of flame coming at us, rapidly advancing towards structures, that's going to change how I might triage those structures versus a small creeping ground fire. How many resources do I have? Do I have one task force for 40 homes, or do I have four task forces for five homes? It changes things. And so that's how you guys need to be thinking as you look at these homes and say, what can I do? What kind of prep work needs to be done? And again, like I said, time. How quickly before the fire is going to be at these structures? How much time do I have to get in there? So when we talk about what kind of prep work needs to be done to make this home better, a better chance of withstanding the fire that's coming, all this is going to be a big factor on what you guys decide as task force leaders, what needs to be done, and come, you know, let me know or make your decisions that way. The big thing is I can't be there to help you to decide all these things. We all need to be operating off the same sheet of music to make these decisions in the area that I've said, hey, look, this task force leader, I need you to take this little area over here. And then I got to go off and see what's going on in this area. So when Scott's over in this area as a task force leader, he's going to be making decisions based off the same ideas. And again, these examples may bring up ideas from previous seasons, but you can see as we start to think about the variables, the fire conditions, the time till the fire gets there, and how many resources, that changes how we look at each one of these structures and how we might triage them. So we want to be thinking more along these lines. This is how we want to start processing and deciding how we triage homes. So structure prep. So we talked about conditions, variables equals our structure category. That's going to tell us what we need to do for structure prep, okay? And this is, again, where we need to get into a common language, a common expectation of what this means. So really what Alex and I have been working on, and we're going to try and offer you over the next few months up into the 2017 season, is the way to think about this is the fire going to be here any moment, or do I have time? Okay? And so when I'm communicating to Scott as a task force leader of task force one, he's going to be looking at it and saying, hey, I've got time. And he's going to call me up and say, hey, I can do surface prep or I can do full prep on this area of homes. Okay? This is the language we all want to get to. So we're going to talk about what that is, what those things are, surface prep and full prep. Surface prep, when we talk about surface prep, and this is the expectation that the IMT program would have of you guys when we go out, surface prep is going to consist of three things, and this is in order of priority. And we're going to talk about why, and Andy's going to jump up here, I'm sure he is, here in a few minutes, and talk about stress, a few things about why the roof might be our first priority. The big thing is a lot of research coming out of Missoula, Montana, is that it's the receptive fuel beds of needle litter on a roof or in gutters or around the base of a house. That's what's burning structures down after we have to leave, if we have to prep and then go, or something gets there where we can't defend it as much just by what the resources we have there. And so it's this roof that we need to focus on. And so when Scott says, hey, Chris, I've got homes over here and we are going to be able to do surface prep before the fire hits, great. I know that he's going to be focusing on the roof areas and those receptive fuel beds, cleaning the gutters, because we're going to show you a video in a bit about why this is one of the key things that we can do for prepping structures. The interior. I know we've talked about a lot, as firefighters, wildland firefighters over the years throughout our training, that it's, you know, said, hey, if you can get in, close the windows, close the drapes, move furniture away from the windows, those type of things. Research is finding that is not actually the only thing that's really helpful is just closing the windows and the exterior doors. Everything else, those drapes, doesn't matter. The radiant heat that comes in is not going to play an issue with those drapes. So really, when we talk about interior stuff, if you can, in surface prep mode, if Scott's there, if you can just get in and close those windows and close the exterior doors, that's all we care about. And then the exterior, remove any of the wood piles, anything, furniture or from around the house, move it away from the house to a garage area, an enclosure that will protect it, and then clear the decks, the walkways. Again, we're hitting those receptive fuel beds that are immediately right around the house, a deck, those areas. This is what they're finding is the most important when a fire is impinged upon by embers. It's not a wave of a fire front that's burning structures down. It's this embers and the hot gases that are pushing over and getting into these fine fuel beds and these little pockets of needles or et cetera, that's what takes out a house. So when Scott says, hey, Chris, we've got 10 ohms over here. We've got enough time for surface prep. This is what I know he's been working on. Whether he's had time to get all the way to the exterior and through everything, that's fine. I trust him and that he's going to do as much as he can in that time, but I know he's going to have started on the roof and the gutters. Now, if the variables that we've been talking about, fire conditions, time, and resources, say that Scott tells me, Chris, I can do full prep, that's great, because I know that he's done all the surface prep, the roof, the interior, the exterior, and he's gone on to two more items. A little more on the exterior, where you might be limbing up some trees that are right immediately adjacent to the structure, shut off any gas services, and he might be applying some foam or gels if he has that, removing vegetation farther out, 30 feet, any other debris or embers, any fences that would block access for the crews operating around the structure. This is what I would understand if Scott told me he had time to do full prep on his area of homes. It's a little different because oftentimes, in my experience, I've seen crews from different places around the state, and this is, not pointing any fingers, but I'm just saying crews come in, and the first thing when they think about prep, structure prep, is limbing up. Now the research is showing that really that's something that only should happen if we have a lot of time, and if we determine that when the fire hits, the fire condition that does hit, is going to be such that we can't stay there, maybe we're going to do full prep because we're going to affect their home and their vegetation around it that significantly because of the fire that's coming and we can't stay there, then we should do full prep. That's what I'm going to understand what Scott says for that. So and you can see that he's still worked through the priorities, roof, interior, exterior, and then these secondary priorities. We're getting onto that common language where he tells me that and I know what he's talking about. The expectations are there that he knows the first thing he should do is roof. So this is the video that we want to show you, and this is a video from Dr. Cohen that Andy said he was going to talk at length about, but now I find myself talking about. And you'll see his research they've done on how a home catches fire.
We can show this several times, but pay close attention to the order of events that's going on here. And then we can go back and talk about these prep standards a little bit. And this is going to tell you the whole story. This is a really short video. Maybe it's a minute long.
Okay, good job.
We need to suppress.
So that, just to give you the background, single family dwelling, single story, Dutch gable roof, non-combustible, well, it's a Class A roof. It's not a metal roof. It's a shingled roof, vinyl gutters, bark dust and ornamentals. What was the very first thing that burned? The bark dust burned first. What was the second thing that burned? The gutters. And what was burning in the gutters? Those gutters were clean. What was burning in the gutters? It was a collection of the, if we can watch it again, but it, when it came in, the embers were collecting on the roof. Gravity took them down into the gutters where they built up, and they actually, in this case, they were vinyl gutters, so they in fact caught on fire. But if you had combustible debris in the gutters, which is common, they're going to catch the edge of the sheathing of the roof on fire. So Dr. Cohen's work, if I was to sum it up in just a few words, is don't worry about radiant heat. Don't worry about ornamentals. Worry about receptive fuels that are close to a building material that's got a small enough mass that those receptive fuels will catch it on fire. So the edge of the plywood, the edge of the siding, the spot where the chimney meets the roof, these places where this stuff can collect and then pass the heat on to a very small piece of the structure that then will spread it to the rest of the building. So the idea of cutting ornamentals down on structures, it doesn't do any good. All you're doing is it's ruining their landscape if their house is not exposed. One of the things that Chris is talking about is how much time we have in and what's the expected fire behavior. It's also the risk, because when you go to the level two prepping that he's talking about, translate that level two into damage. You are now damaging their property, and if the fire never shows up, we're not going to have happy customers, right? So we're only going to damage properties when we need to. Level one prep or the surface prep, there's no damage to the structure unless something weird goes on. Structure fires, consider them spot fires. They're not radiant fires. They're not from the fire front. They are strictly spot fires, and we have to focus on preventing the spot fires. So your focus on prepping are those things that are going to burn. And the places you have to look are where it's right next to the structure, and things, if it had been snowing at the time, where would that snow drift to? That's where the embers are going to drift to, and you have to make sure there are no receptive fuels in those areas. So Dr. Cohen's recommendations are, our major tools are blowers, weed eaters, and rakes. Rake the bark dust and other combustibles away from the building. Rake all the dead leaf material from below the ornamentals, blow off the roof. If you have a Class A roof, he's not so worried about the stuff in the field, because it will take a short period of exposure. His number one thing was the gutters and the areas, but if you have a time, get the whole roof clean and get 5 feet from around the house clear of all receptive fuels, and you have a much higher chance of saving that structure. Are you going to talk about sprinkler kits later? Is that later in your...
I'll let you bring that up.
Sprinkler kits. How many of you guys put up sprinkler kits? How many of you guys witnessed the sprinkler kits' effectiveness? And was it good or bad? Where were you guys at? I'm
Douglas Complex.
The Douglas Complex. Okay. Were those structures prepped before they were sprinklered? Okay. The rule of thumb on sprinkler kits is they only work if you adequately prep the house. If you don't go through and do those things that we go basically to the full prep, the sprinkler kit will do basically nothing. And just don't bother to waste your time. The reasons being are is it's very difficult to get a sprinkler kit to bring the moisture content up in all of those areas that we're talking about, the gutters, the roof, all those areas. And it's the timing of the sprinkler kits. And so I saw a lot of burned up sprinkler kits last year, and a lot of burned up buildings right next to the burned up sprinkler kits. And if you don't prep the building, the sprinkler kit does nothing. It's kind of fun, but it doesn't do anything. You have to adequately prep the structures.
I thought this image from the video was probably the most telling for me, because I know we've all been out there and we've come upon that structure, and the valleys in the roof are full of needles that have accumulated, and the gutters are full, and there's just combustible debris all around the house. Look what burned in this example, this test fire they did. And so it brought it all together, the research that this Dr. Cohen from Missoula has been doing, and what we're trying to get across is, this is why the roof, and this is number one, the highest priority when we say prep of any type, whether it's surface prep or full prep.
He said if you're in a huge hurry and you don't have time, take some rags, plug the gutters, and fill the gutters with water. That's the best thing you can do for a house before you leave.
Just a couple things. So that video that we just watched, if you're kind of a go back on defensible or our triage category. So if we have a standalone, right, we consider standalone what? A standalone structure, what do we normally consider that? We drive by and we see that it's in an open field, maybe in a rock pit, and we go, we don't have to mess with it, right? So take that structure with the receptive field beds, maybe some needles. It's got a tree line that's 100 yards away. It's got needles, leaves that are on or around that structure. And we do kind of do a drive-by and say, that's a standalone structure. It looks pretty good, kind of from the bird's eye view. And we keep driving. And then we end up getting a fire front that comes through with an ember shower. Now we have a structure fire, right? We have that spot fire. So just one of the important parts on standalone, we want standalone to be standalone. So when we're triaging our structures, we want to make sure that we take a look at the standalone structures and make sure that they're completely standalone. We've done all of our surface prep. If we've got time, any little full prep. So just because we classify it standalone doesn't necessarily mean that it's standalone. And so that's just something to consider. The other part of that, I think, just in touching on this, so surface prep, when we were taking a look at surface prep versus full prep, how many configurations have we been on or deployments we've been on where we are in an area, patrolling an area, maybe triaging the structures, and we're not sure if the fire is actually going to end up coming into that zone, right? I would say that's probably about 50-50 on the fires that we go on. It's paralleling. We're not exactly sure if fire is going to make the turn, but we've got to make a presence. We've got to be there because there is a certain amount of risk. And so my experience is there are times where we'll go triage, and we might do a lighthearted triage, and we are not sure what to do at that point. Do we prep? Do we not prep? What's our liability? There's all these questions that have come up, and I think that's part of the reason why we're standing up here today. There are things that you can do. The surface prep, that is something that you can do, and potentially you have tons of time. I would say on Canyon Creek last year, the fire in certain areas where we had sprinkler kits and we learned a few things, but some of the areas, the fire front didn't reach those areas for 9 to 10 days. And we had plenty of time to do some surface prep and then hopefully establish some trigger points for full prep. But as much of that as we can get out of the way early on, I think, the farther we're going to be ahead as the fire progresses or maybe makes a turn. So does that make sense? I think the last thing on full prep, so there's been a lot of questions on, well, what is our liability, right? So we're trying to take that liability away, the worry of liability away from you by saying we've got a plan in place that's going to identify what it is and when we want you to do that. So I think a big part of that is like trees. Do we cut trees down or do we not cut trees down? I think what we're saying is you don't cut trees down, right? Especially if they're deciduous trees, there's no need. Those are heat sink. But we're not going to be cutting trees down. We're going to be limbing up if we go into full prep mode. But we want to minimize the amount of damage. And we obviously want to do things that are prudent to saving that structure. We don't want to do things like cutting trees down just because that's what we've always done, right? So if there's a particular instance, I think it goes back to that relationship, if there's a particular instance where you as a strike team leader, your engine boss feels, hey, you know what, we need to cut these trees down because they're right up against the structure. It would make that structure defensible if we did so. That's a discussion you have, right? So we take that liability on together. Does that make sense? So, and I think that goes with any of the variables when you're triaging and prepping homes that aren't maybe covered in the checklist as we roll that out to you.
So again, I know I hit upon this, but I just want to make sure this is all to develop a common language that we all can talk about. We have an expectation and understanding of the actions we're going to be taking for prepping a structure. And that same idea holds true now that we're going to talk about these tactical actions to defend homes. These are the lists. We got primary tactical actions and secondary tactical actions. And really, we're not reinventing the wheel here. We're taking a lot of what California does in fire scope and making sure it fits within our program. So we'll jump in and the standalone, a primary tactical action. And I think what Alex brings up is a great point is it should be standalone after you've done some prep work on it. You've gone in there, taken a look, done a little prep work, done some surface, you walk away because you need to apply your resources elsewhere to homes that need more of your attention. It should be standalone once you've done some work. I'm not speaking to you from any position that's any better. I'm learning a lot from this year, and that I'm gonna apply next year. So it's something we're all working to improve upon and this understanding of, because I would have driven by some home said, yep, standalone. Let's move on and apply our resources elsewhere that need it. But I think we're learning that standalone is standalone once we put some effort into it. This is a low risk event where we can get in, we have the time, and then we're gonna go apply our efforts elsewhere. So defend and prep, and I apologize if this is hard to see, but so I'll kind of describe these pictures as we go through it. Prep and defend, we're gonna get in there. We're gonna do some good work, whether it's surface prep or we have the time for surface prep or whether it's full prep, and then we're gonna stay and defend this. Got the fire front up there in this picture moving from the top left down. You've got a road right here that you have a viable escape route to an identified safety zone, should you need it. You've got engines with hose lines deployed, available to jump on any spots that are being thrown out ahead of the fire. Maybe you have a dozer working with you or hand crews working to cut a line around, help protect that structure. This is the idea of prep and defend. So again, Scott and I are working together. He comes back and says, hey, as a task force leader, I've looked at it and I've got a couple standalones where we've done some prep work on, and I've got a couple prep and defend homes. I understand what he said, okay? In a very short, concise conversation, I know what he's talking about because now we're all on the same page. Prep and go. This is, we're getting up in risk category. We have the time, the resources to get in here, do some work, but for whatever reason, we can't be there. Whether it's the fire conditions, whether we don't have the resources there, whether the home is, we can't do enough to make it safe for us to defend, whether we're just gonna do a little and go. This is prep and go, where we've got identified escape routes to identified safety zones. We're gonna go in, we're going to pull some lines, take care of any spot fires. We're gonna consider the time until the fire hits the structure and how much, what we can do. And we're gonna concentrate on those receptive fuel beds, that surface prep, hitting the roof, hitting those receptive fuel beds around us before we have to get out. This is the idea of prep and go. Check and go, we're getting much into a higher risk level where we don't have much time. I don't have the resources before the fire. The fire is gonna hit this structure imminently. We come in, and really what we're doing here is we're looking to see what is the life hazard here. I look and I see I've got an identified escape route to an identified safety zone. I'm gonna zip in. Is anybody there that I can encourage or help get out of the structure before the fire hits this? It's a house that it's not safe for me to be there to defend. This is basically a loser because I don't have the time, I don't have the resources before the fire hits, so I want to get in and see, is there someone that I can help them get out? And I think over the last couple seasons, we've all been in those situations where we saw these homes with the old couple who's still living there, and they didn't want to get out when the evacuation order was given, but we know they're there, and if the fire comes, we know we have to go in and try that one last effort to get them out. That's the check and go circumstance. So now we're gonna get into some of our secondary tactical actions. So retreat and re-engage. This is an action plan or a tactical action that Damon Schultz and we used last year on the Coronet Windy Ridge. We had had some time, we'd had about, what was it? Not even a day, but a little bit, almost a couple hours, 4 hours, to work in an area of about 12 to 18 homes. We did what we could, but the fire made its push down into the gulch where we were. We withdrew, watched the fire came in. We were probably, 200 yards away from the fire front, and it did its thing, died down. And with our ops chief, John Ketchum, we kind of watched and checked, and continually over an hour, we assessed. And then when we could go back in, we went back in and re-engaged in the area where we could go back in and do some good. There were homes being threatened. There were some homes on fire. We went back in and did what we could to knock down those fires and save what structures we could. We withdrew and then re-engaged. So again, you have your identified escape routes and safety zones. Always a key point when we're talking about our tactical actions. The fire has passed the homes you're in question. You've got some homes that might be partially involved, maybe some homes that are fully involved. You go through and quickly determine what homes can I re-engage in and go forth and do good work. You're going to keep your access through here open as much as you can, and mobile. You want people mobile, because we all know that conditions change, the wind shifts, and maybe the fire turns and comes back in through. You want to be able to, when that lookout identifies the time, withdraw again if need be, back to your safety zone, and then re-engage if you have to again. That's the concept between retreat and re-engage. Anchor and hold is kind of a good flanking maneuver when you've got a fire pushing along a flank or a roadway, some sort of area where you're holding. In this case, in this drawing, you've got a road, the fire is pushing from right to left. You've got homes that may be fully involved or partially involved that you're anchoring off the road and working on. You're mobile, bumping ahead and hitting spots. And maybe if you had the time, you have a hose lay that's dry, that's already in place that you can pull up to, connect, and you've got water into the hoses that are already pre-positioned at that home. Anchor and hold. You're trying to do what you can to the structures along that flank, prevent it from crossing the road, and doing what you can to help those structures right there. And then bump and run. I think a lot of us who are familiar with this is you're very mobile, moving along again your egress routes, a couple engines moving past each other, alternating from homes, doing what you can, taking action on fires, as it says here, keeping an eye out for spot fires, moving in on homes and engaging, and then moving on to the next one. Limited resources, but you can move along with the fire or along an area and do what you can to minimize the potential involvement on any structures. And then finally, tactical patrol. If Scott said, hey, Chris, today we're going to be doing a lot of tactical patrol. I know that he's going to be moving through an area, whether he's in mop-up mode or whether he's in an area that has a chance of the fire coming back through or something. I know that he's going to be working in, he's going to be patrolling, making sure that no hot spots come back up if the fire is moving through that area. Those type of actions. These are the secondary tactical actions. So you can see, if we all begin to be on the same page, and even if it's two task forces are working together from differing parts of the state, if you guys are going to say, hey, we're going to work together and we're going to do some anchor and hold along this area, the two task forces now can understand, have a common language, and can begin to play well with each other because they're on the same page, on the same sheet of music as far as what you're going to do. So that's what we got. We kind of talked about the partnership between the division soup and the task force leader, and I do think it's very much a partnership. We went over triaging structures and the common language that we'd like to start developing among all the task forces around the state, the expectation for structure protection, surface prep, the importance of working on the roof and the receptive fuel beds, full prep, what that means, and then our tactical actions. A lot of information, and I think we'll hopefully be hearing more about it over the next year or so, if the ICs eventually give us the thumbs up.
Good job, Chris. Excellent.